Hello everyone. So in continuation with the constituents
of normal
fluid, we'll
just briefly summarize
today about the physical characteristics first. So volume,
after briefly summarizing,
800 to 2500 ml is excreted per day.
Normal urine.
But it also depends upon the quantity of fluid intake, the climate change, and physical exercise. On an average, a human being will excrete 1500 ml per day. Appearance of fresh urine sample is clear and transparent. However, on standing, that is on keeping for a long time, the urine becomes turbid. The bacterial action converts urea into ammonia. This makes the urine alkaline, which causes precipitation of phosphates, oxalates, and urates. The color of a fresh urine sample is straw colored to amber colored. The presence of pigment urochrome imparts the color to the urine. So you must remember that the color of urine is because of the pigment urochrome. Now the odor of normal urine is aromatic. The presence of volatile organic acids give this odor to urine. On standing, the urine gives ammoniacal smell due to conversion of urea present in urine into ammonia by bacterial action. The pH of urine ranges from acidic to alkaline. On an average, it is around 6. pH is around 6, which is mildly acidic. The reason for the pH is the protein diet, which makes the urine acidic. The diets rich in fruits and vegetables make it alkaline. On standing, urine becomes alkaline due to ammonia formation. Urine also becomes alkaline after meals. The specific gravity of urine ranges from 1.012 to 1.024. The fluid intake and specific gravity have reciprocal relationship. So this is about the physical characteristics. So I'll quickly discuss with you the chemical characteristics of normal urine. As you know, it includes tests for organic compounds and tests for inorganic compounds. Now, among the tests for organic compounds, we have some NPN substances, which are urea, creatinine, uric acid, and ammonia. For urea, we do sodium hypobromide test, urease test, and biuret test. So there are three tests in all that can be performed for urea. For creatinine, we do the Jaffe's test. For uric acid, we do the phosphotungstic acid test. And for ammonia, we do the inorganic substance test for ammonia. So ammonia is basically an inorganic substance. Here, however, I have clubbed it into NPN substances, that is non-protein nitrogen substances. The other organic substances which are non-nitrogenous include hippuric acid and ethyl sulfate. So in all, there are 5 organic compounds present in urine that have to be tested, which are urea, uric acid, creatinine, hippuric acid, and ethyl sulfate. Now, tests for inorganic compounds include the inorganic sulfate, for which we do the sulfate test, phosphate, for which we do the phosphate test, and chloride, for which we do the chloride test. It also includes ammonia, for which we do the test for ammonia. So now you can see that there are 3 groups here, that is test for organic compound, test for NPN substances, and test for inorganic substances. So in exam, you may be asked you may be just given a simple question: find out the normal constituents of urine. So in which you have to do all the 11 tests. Now, if you are asked, carry out the test for NPN substances present in normal urine. For this, you have to carry out the 6 tests, that is 3 tests for urea, 1 for creatinine, 1 for uric acid, and 1 for ammonia. So depending upon the question, you have to perform the tests. Now, I would also like to discuss briefly about the non-nitrogenous compounds. So we'll just see the reference value, biological function, and diagnostic importance of each of these compounds. We'll begin with urea. So you know that urea is a normal constituent of urine. It is excreted around 25 to 30 grams per day. And in blood, that is in serum, it is present in a concentration of 15 to 45 milligrams per dl. Urea is a major end product of protein catabolism. Its major biological function is detoxification of ammonia, which is done by the formation of urea. So the synthesis of urea occurs in liver. Okay, so just don't think that urea is a waste product. It actually has a big role in detoxifying ammonia. Now, why detoxification of ammonia is needed, we'll discuss shortly. The diagnostic importance of doing urea is because whenever there is increased excretion of urea, it may be due to high protein diet, fever, or diabetes mellitus, to name a few causes. Decreased excretion indicates liver malfunction, nephritis, and acidosis. The second non-nitrogenous protein compound is uric acid. In urine, it is excreted as 5.5 to 0.8 grams per day, and in serum, it has difference in values. In males, it is 3.5 to 7 milligrams per deciliter, whereas in males, it is 2.5 to 6 milligrams per deciliter. Uric acid is also a waste product. It is the end product of purine metabolisms. And as you know, purines, example of purines are adenine and guanine. The increased excretion of uric acid is seen in leukemia, cytotoxic drug therapy. It is also seen in Wilson's disease and in case of administration of cortisone, or the decreased excretion is seen in renal failure. Now, whenever there is increased uric acid in blood, the person may have hyperuricemia and which may result in gout. Creatinine, in urine, it is excreted around 1 to 1.8 grams per day. In serum, among males, 0.7 to 1.3 milligrams per deciliter is the normal range, whereas in females, the normal reference range is 0.6 to 1.1 milligram per deciliter. Creatinine is the end product of muscle creatine phosphate, which is synthesized from three amino acids, glycine, arginine, and methionine. The form of methionine that is used is S-adenosylmethionine. So creatinine is basically the end product of creatine, which is a energy source in muscle, and it is used for muscle contraction. Now, increased excretion of creatinine is seen when there is high intake of meat, fish, in case of fever and myopathy and wasting disease, also creatinine excretion increases. The decreased excretion is seen in renal failure, anemia, and paralysis. So creatinine is an excellent marker for assessment of renal functions. Now, ammonia. Ammonia in urine is excreted around 0.7 to 0.8 grams per day, and in serum it is present in very low amounts, which is 15 to 60 micrograms per deciliter. Now ammonia present in urine comes from the metabolism of amino acid glutamine. In the kidneys, glutamine is metabolized to release ammonia, which is excreted along with urine. Ammonia is highly toxic to the brain and central nervous system, so it cannot stay in the body or in circulation for very long time. So the body has found a wonderful mechanism of detoxifying ammonia and converting major part of ammonia into urea, which we have already discussed. The increased excretion of urea is seen in acidosis, impaired protein metabolism, and decreased excretion is seen in alkalosis. So I think this gives you the idea of why NPN compounds are so important and what are their biological roles as well as their diagnostic importance. Now, in conclusion, for normal urine, we saw that it is a pale yellow or in color or straw in color. The normal urine has acidic pH and it has aromatic odor. The normal urine contains organic constituents like urea, uric acid, creatinine, hippuric acid and ethyl sulfate, and the inorganic constituents are chloride, sulfate, phosphate, calcium and ammonia. Now we'll come to some very important questions. So we'll begin with why does urine become alkaline? Now we'll see two conditions. One is after meals and the second one we'll discuss in the next slide. So you've heard me say mentioning number of times that urine becomes alkaline after meals. So now the next question is, why does it become alkaline after meals? What happens in our body? So let us see. The presence of food in stomach stimulates the formation of HCl by parietal cells. Now in exchange, the parietal cells secrete HCO3 or bicarbonate in blood, which makes venous blood more alkaline. This is called alkaline tide. The excessive bicarbonate will be excreted by kidney and it will make the urine alkaline. So you can see what happens after meals when the food reaches the stomach. There is a need for hydrochloric acid so that the proteins and the enzymes are activated. So the H ions of hydrochloric acid will come from bicarbonate and the chloride will come from the circulation, and both these will combine to form HCl, and this HCl will activate various enzymes in the stomach and carry out protein digestion. Now this HCO3 of the bicarbonate will be released in the bloodstream, which is excreted by the kidneys with urine. Now as this HCO3 comes into the blood, there is a change in pH and it becomes alkaline. And as this is excreted in urine, the urine also becomes alkaline after the meals. Why does urine become alkaline on keeping for a long time is the next question, which I discussed in physical characteristics, that if the urine is left in a container for long time, it becomes alkaline. This is because the bacteria begins to split the urea. Bacteria have an enzyme known as urease enzyme. They split urea into ammonia and carbon dioxide, and because of this splitting, the ammonia that is released makes the urine alkaline. There's one more important point for you to note, that when the urine becomes alkaline, the transparency of the urine will be gradually lost because various salts will be precipitated. So in order to avoid this, either we add some preservatives and we refrigerate the urine if it will be examined after 2 hours. So if the urine sample is kept for 2 hours, it may maintain its pH and its transparency, but beyond that the bacterial action would have taken over. So it is very important to note that urine sample should be preserved in the refrigerator with proper preservatives. Now the next important point is, what inference can you draw from specific gravity of urine? So we know that specific gravity of urine of a 24-hour sample lies between 1.01 to 1.024. And in urine analysis, specific gravity is carried out to evaluate kidney function, and it is helpful in the diagnosis of various diseases. So it's a very important parameter. Now let us see what all we can come to know by seeing the specific gravity. If specific gravity is less than more than 1.016, this is known as hypoosmolar condition. It is because the amount of solutes per unit volume of urine decrease, and this is seen in diabetes insipidus and compulsive polydipsia. If the specific gravity is more than 1.025, it is known as hyperosmolar. The condition is seen when the amount of solutes per unit volume increases. And this is seen in diabetes mellitus due to glucose, in severe dehydration where the amount of water decreases, in nephrotic syndrome where the presence of protein is in excess, and in adrenal insufficiency where the presence of excessive sodium chloride in urine makes it hyperosmolar, and so the specific gravity will increase. The next condition is when the specific gravity remains constant at 1.010. This is known as isosthenuria. It means that the specific gravity is fixed. This is seen when the ratio of solutes per unit volume of urine remains same to that of solvent. And such a condition is seen in diseases like chronic renal failure, alcohol ingestion, and certain drugs such as diuretics and lithium. The next important question which must be occurring in your mind is, what is hippuric acid? I've been telling you that hippuric acid is a compound which is seen only in urine now, and it is a normal constituent of urine. So why is it a normal constituent of urine, and what is it? Now, as you all know, we consume lot of packet foods, and most of these packet foods contain a preservative known as benzoic acid. So this benzoic acid on reaching liver undergoes conjugation so that it can be removed out of the body by making it water soluble. So benzoic acid in the liver reacts with glycine. This reaction is known as conjugation, where the insoluble benzoic acid becomes a soluble hippuric acid, which is nothing but a acyl glycine. This hippuric acid is excreted along with urine, so it is known as a normal component of urine. Hippuric acid also is a biomarker of conjugation of the liver cells, because it is the function of liver to carry out conjugation. So if hippuric acid conversion occurs, that means the conjugation function of liver is working well. The other important question is, what is ethyl sulfate? This is also an organic compound which is found in urine. Let us see, what is it exactly? Now, you know that there are various foods that are rich in protein, and if this protein contains large amount of tryptophan, when it reaches the large intestine, the intestinal bacteria find tryptophan very interesting for their metabolism. So they just feast on it and they convert all the tryptophan into indole. Now this indole, part of it is excreted as feces, and a part of it is sent to the liver, where it is undergoing conjugation to form indoxyl sulfate. This indoxyl sulfate now goes to the kidneys, and it is excreted out in urine. So you can see, dietary protein which is rich in tryptophan is converted to indole by E. coli. Some of the indole is excreted in feces, and the remaining goes to the liver. In the liver, the conjugation reaction occurs where indole is converted to indoxyl sulfate, and this indoxyl sulfate is excreted along with urine by the kidneys. So this is ethyl sulfate. Thank you for watching. Make your notes and complete your journals. Keep reading. Keep enjoying.